Show me that video real quick that I had sent you. I sent you a video last night. Start at 4 minutes real quick. Now, the only reason I'm showing this video is so you brothers and sisters can feel comforted by where you at, okay? Because I'm going to tell you something. It's a lot of people out here that know that they're Israelites, right? A lot of people. Like, we go to places we teach on the street, and we be like, yeah, you know you an Israelite. What's your nationality? Brother be like, I'm an Israelite from the tribe of Judah. But he got a cigarette in his hand. You know what I'm saying? He like, damn. You understand? Sisters, too, you be like, hey, sis, I'm an Israelite. I know I'm an Israelite. Spandex on. I'm like, God, dog. So it showed that we still got a lot to teach our people. We got to teach our people the commandments because our people don't know the commandments. We got to teach it to them, right? You ready? Yes. Start at 4 minutes. I'm going to show you this. These brothers, they know they're Israel. I think they might be a branch off from another Israelite camp or whatever. I really don't care. Only reason I'm showing it is so that you can see that where you at is the right place and that the commandments are of the utmost importance. All right? So show that. Can't hear, bro. Hold on. Start over at 4 minutes. Yeah, that's good.
Let me remind everybody, we love your comments, but we want everybody to stay focused on what we dealing with, what topic we dealing with. You know,
right, on top.
So we don't need you to be in the room having three or four different conversations going. So I done let my other people that work with me to let you know when you get off the topic, we're gonna ask you to please stay focused on the topic that we're dealing with, and one because it causes confusion and you're throwing other people off. But then I want to mention what you guys was talking. What they was talking about was talking about birthdays, holidays, and they saying all birthdays and holidays is pagan. I can't read that nowhere in the Bible. And you know,
pause. So this brother got his own little chat or whatever chat room. He do videos, and some people was in the chat room because I guess he mentioned something about a holiday, and the people was like, "Hey man, y'all not supposed to be celebrating birthdays, and all holidays is pagan. We shouldn't be keeping them." So he goes on to say in his pride that he can't read that in the Bible, right? He don't read nowhere in the Bible where it say you can't keep birthdays and certain holidays and so on and so forth, right? Go ahead.
The thing is, the Lord said, I'm going to judge you by the thing that's written in the Bible.
That's right.
I can't read it in the Bible, and then I got on a big old shirt with big old red letters saying, if you can't read it, don't believe it.
Don't believe.
And then I started telling somebody about, hey, you know, birthdays is pagan. Mother's Day is pagan. And then they said, can you read that to me in the Bible? Could you read that to me? Could you read that to me in the Bible? Then what I'm going to say? Well, you know, every time you get to something, you can't say, learn not the way of the heathen. I'm pretty sure when you was over in Africa and scattered among the Canaanites, you didn't wear no suits. You didn't wear nothing like this. Why you learn that way? And then guess what you do on Sunday? Like the same thing I did yesterday. I learned the way of the heathen. I was watching football. I bet Jesus and his disciples didn't go to not one football game. They didn't do that. But if it's not in the Bible, in my room, brothers and sisters, we can't deal with it. Because other than that, when somebody put the finger on me and say, can you read that in the Bible? I'm going to be lost. Well, it ain't in the Bible, but you know, you go look up this history book. No, you can't do that. See, what you supposed to.
Okay, you can pull that down. Go to Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. You got a mic also, Zariah? Okay, good. Go to Colossians chapter 2 and verse 8. So I just wanted to open up with that video so you can see that there are a lot of our brothers and sisters that know that they're Israelites, but they're lost in understanding. It is because they deny the commandments of God. Go to Colossians chapter 2, verse 8.
The book of Colossians chapter 2 and verse 8. Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit.
The Bible says, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. One of you brothers, can anyone give me a definition of philosophy? What is a philosophy? Just give me an example. Any brother? No brothers can give me an example. Okay, brother right here, give him a mic. Give me an example of a philosophy, brother.
A philosophical thought.
Okay, philosophical thought. Like, give me an example of like what? What would be a philosophical thought?
For example, that you can see life. That you can see life like a half cup of water. You can see it either half empty or half full.
Oh, okay. Okay, yeah, that is a philosophy. You're right. Now, based on the world. Good job. There's another brother raising hand, Brother Gideon. Good job, brother. Brother Gideon, give me another example of a philosophy. The brother said the philosophy of you see the half empty or half full. What you say?
White Jesus.
White Jesus is a philosophy, right? It can't be proven. It can't be substantiated. That's right. So a philosophy is something that can't be proven. Like you ask a Christian, why do you celebrate Christmas? And they'll say it's the birth of Christ. Then you go in the Bible and show them, well, Christ was born in the springtime. You understand? Around the Passover. And then so why do you celebrate Christmas? Oh, I do it for the kids. Okay, well, first you say you did it for Christ. Now I done proved that wrong. Now you say you do it for the kids. That's a philosophy. That's something that can't be proven, right? So read it again.
Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit.
Vain deceit is a lie. Come on.
After the tradition of men.
After the tradition of men. Now, are birthdays a tradition of men, or can I read where they're commanded in the Bible? A birthday, is it a tradition of men, or is it something that God commanded us to keep in the Bible? It's a tradition of men, right? I can't read a scripture that says that I should celebrate it, therefore I shouldn't do it, right? So, and we're going to get into it in a minute. So it says, after the tradition of men, read.
After the rudiments of the world.
Fundamentals of the world, go ahead.
And not after Christ.
So did Christ celebrate his birthday? Okay, so we're supposed to be doing what Christ did, right? Go from there. Go to Job chapter 1, like also Obadiah was saying. Go to Job chapter 1 real quick. We're just going to touch on it real quick because we're talking about keeping the Feast of Dedication today. And there's other holidays, worldly holidays that's going on right now. You got Thanksgiving coming up, or Thanksgiving is what we call it, because it's the celebration of the slaughter of the Native American Indians. And then you got Christmas, right, which has nothing to do with Christ, right? We got that coming up. We got New Year's coming up, right? So you got all these things coming up that the world looks forward to. But we understand that the Bible tells us we're supposed to be following after Christ and not the tradition of men. Go to Job chapter 1. You know what I want?
Verse 4?
Or you want to start at 1? Yes, you can start at 4.
Yes, sir.
The book of Job chapter 1 and verse 4. And his sons went and feasted in their houses, every one his day.
Wait a minute. It says every one his day. Now, did that mean that they just chose Tuesday? Like, yeah, I'm going to feast in my house Tuesday. You at yours on Thursday. You at yours on Sunday. Or was this day specific to them, special to them? It was special to them. That's why he uses the terminology or uses the pronoun his. It was his day, right? Would you have something to say? You want something?
Yeah, y'all on Facebook, right? Some of y'all on Facebook. And y'all see some of y'all worldly friends might have a birthday coming up. And or that particular day, and someone will say, happy birthday, enjoy your what? That's what he's talking about. Everyone, right. His day. That's why they say enjoy your day, because you become the God of that day.
Right.
All praise.
You idolizing yourself. That's exactly what you're doing. That's my day. But hell, it's a million people that got that same day. You understand? Don't make no sense. And how is your day when it's different every year? Goofball. Think about it. That's some goofy. We crazy. Man, you know, man, today my day, man. Well, next year, tomorrow going to be your day because it's going to be on Tuesday. You know, we just really just thinking logically. We don't think. We just follow the customs of men. Go ahead, Austin.
Hey, they try to get slick nowadays. They'll say, it's not my birthday. It's my born date.
Wow.
It's crazy.
Anything to break God's commandments and follow the so-called white man. Read it now. Verse 5 again.
Verse four again? Yes, sir. And his sons went and feasted in their house.
So they had a feast in their house. Read.
Everyone his day.
Everyone on their birthday. Read.
And sent and called for their three sisters to eat and to drink with them.
Go ahead.
And it was so, when the days of their feasting were gone about, that Job sent and sanctified them and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned.
Wait a minute. Now, Job was perfect and upright and eschewed with evil. Now, why would he go sacrifice an animal or offer an animal to atone for the sin of his sons and daughters if what they was doing wasn't sin? Them celebrating their birthday, his day, was sin. Because it goes outside. Because remember, the Lord said, keep the what holy? The Sabbath day holy. Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Any other day you keep it holy or sanctifying to yourself is sin. Go ahead.
For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually.
So Job sacrificed animals to atone for the sins of his sons and daughters because birthdays is sin. You understand that? Go to Job 3 and 1.
Job chapter 3 and verse 1. After this, opened Job his mouth and cursed his day.
You hear this? Job said he cursed his day. Let's see what that is. Read.
And Job spake and said, let the day perish wherein I was born.
So his day is the day that Job was born. Read.
And the night in which it was said, there is a man child conceived.
So our forefather Job understood that birthdays were sin, that we shouldn't be celebrating our birthday. None of our ancestors ever did. Christ didn't do it. Therefore, we shouldn't do it. But you'll have brothers and or sisters that want to hold on to man-made traditions, and they'll go into the Bible and try to justify, or they'll use semantics like, you can't watch football. Is it sin to watch a football game? That's not sin. It ain't sin for me to watch a football game, watch a basketball game. That's not sin. Is it sin to be on the Sabbath day to go spend money to go sit in the stadium and watch it? You damn right it is. You understand? I wouldn't do that. But say one of my family members invite me to their basketball game on a Tuesday night. Am I in sin for going to watch the game? No, you're not. So that's called semantics. You understand? To try to keep our brothers and sisters in sin, keep them doing things that's not right in the eyes of God. Okay? Go from there. Go to Mark chapter 7 and verse 6. So that was birthdays. We dealt with that. Mark 7, verse 6. So it said, rudiments of the world, not after Christ. Read what you got.
Mark chapter 7 and verse 6. He answered and said unto them, well hath Esaias prophesied of you hypocrites.
Esaias is Isaiah. Go ahead.
As it is written, this people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me.
Read.
Howbeit in vain do they worship me.
So our people say they love God so much. They love Jesus so much. I love the Lord. But when it comes time to keep God's commandments, then it's a problem. Like, for instance, some of you, you're going to hear certain things in the scriptures, and you ain't going to like it. Your husband, for you married women, going to bring something out, and you're going to be like, what? I got to do, man. You understand? Some of you brothers, you're going to be doing something, and one of the leadership, one of these officers or soldiers, your fellow brother, going to point it out to you, say, hey, bro, that's sin you're doing. You need to stop watching that. You need to stop doing that. That's sin. And you're going to be mad. You're not going to like it. I'm going to tell you right now. But if you love the Lord, you'll find it within yourself to say, okay, they showed it to me in the Bible. I can't do this no more. You understand? Because you want to love the Lord. But these brothers and sisters that they're prophesying of right here, they love the Lord when it comes to speech. But when it comes down to do what the Lord say, they're not going to do it. Right? Go ahead.
Teaching for doctrines the commandments of men.
Read it from the top again, verse 7.
Verse 7. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men.
So they teach for doctrines the commandments of men. Christmas is a doctrine that they teach. And they say that that's a commandment. You should keep it. You understand? It's Christ's birthday. You don't celebrate Christ's birthday to make you feel bad. You ain't going to dress your kids up. You ain't going to see your mom on Thanksgiving. You ain't going to call your daddy today. It's his birthday. He hit 100 years old today. That's a blessing, brother. And you looking like, nah, I ain't calling dad on. Nah, I'll call my daddy today just to say, shalom, I love you. I ain't calling him on his birthday, though. You understand? Because we don't celebrate that. It's not in the Bible. But they'll make you feel bad about that. They'll say you're in a cult. You're in a cult, but they dressing their children up as ghouls and goblins and demons and ghosts and prostitutes. Hey, pull that thing up. Pull that thing up, your boy Nas X. This Negro dressed up like Nicki Minaj, man. Show it. I got to see it. Show it. We a cult, though. We a cult. Remember that.
So like last Saturday was when that was, when the Halloween
was. That was a week before.
Right. Yep. So they were dressing up like demons on Saturday night. And Sunday they supposed to be casting out Satan.
Wow.
Ha. Come on, man.
This is why the Bible says what it says. Hey, show that, bro. This a man. This is a man. This your boy that's saying, had y'all in here. Y'all was in here two-stepping to that song.
We didn't know. We didn't know. We didn't know.
We went on and out some.
Man. Right.
This is a brother. This is a man, bro. This is Sodom and Gomorrah, bro. Right. I don't even really believe he gay. I think he do this for the money.
Right.
I think he did this for the money. Because when he first came out with that song, it wasn't until after the song went number one, all of a sudden he came out gay. I don't believe it. But this Sodom and Gomorrah. So our people, that's him in a dress. It's Halloween. Hey. It's a Halloween costume.
He did.
Mark 7 and 8.
Dang. Chapter 7 and verse 8.
The brothers ain't right, man. But we a cult, though. Go ahead.
For laying aside the commandment of God.
So they lay aside Passover. They won't keep it. Feast of dedication, they won't keep it. Nah, that's a Jewish religion. We ain't got to do that no more. We new creatures in Christ. We ain't got to do that. Christ did away with the Old Testament. We ain't got to do it. So it said, for laying aside the commandment of God, read.
Behold the tradition of men.
They hold a tradition of men. They hold Christmas close. Thanksgiving close. Read.
As the washing of pots and cups and many other such like things ye do.
Read.
And he said unto them, full well ye reject the commandment of God.
So you reject the Passover which Christ kept, feast dedication which Christ kept. You can reject that. Read.
That ye may keep your own tradition.
But that you can keep your own tradition. Read 13.
Verse 13. Making the word of God of none effect through your tradition.
Read.
Which ye have delivered.
Read.
And many such like things do ye.
See, so Christ is saying, look, I ain't got to list all the things y'all do. I can tell you a few things y'all do. Just like we ain't got to go through all the different holidays. We know what our people doing. You understand? This is what the scripture is saying. It's like things ye do. It's a lot of traditions of men our people keeping. Right? Go from there. What did Christ keep? Go to Matthew 26, 17. What did Christ keep? Yeah, go ahead, Austin.
Let me just pull one scripture to go with that. Go to Matthew 15:3. It's saying the same thing you're reading here in Mark 7 and 9. Matthew 15:3. I just real fast, Austin.
Yes, sir.
No, bring it out.
Matthew chapter 15 and verse 3.
Uh-huh.
But he answered and said unto them, why do ye also transgress the commandment of God?
Because sometimes we'll transgress the commandments of God to do what?
By your tradition.
By our tradition. That tradition of your birthday. That tradition of Thanksgiving. That tradition of Christmas. We'll transgress the law of God for this tradition. So all praise. Christ just bringing it out to the brothers.
And it's real simple. Like he said, like if somebody might say, well, if it don't say thou shalt not celebrate birthday, then I ain't going to do it. A lot of times we'll get real simple. When you see in Job, everybody in here can see in Job, it says don't celebrate. Everyone celebrated his day and it was a sin. We all see that, right? Don't let people play no semantics. Does it say Jesus was black in the Bible? Does it say he was that. Black?
Right.
If
right.
it don't say that, I don't believe it.
Right.
People will get simple real fast.
But can't see air, but know they breathing. You understand? I ain't never read the label on nothing that they eat, but it tell you it's good for them. Like, you just like, man, come on, stop with that. If we won't do that, like, if y'all, for me, I like to play that game. You want to play that game? We can play that game. We can go real deep on some stuff that you ain't never read that you do every single day of your life. Ain't nobody ever read the back of the tube of toothpaste. But you know it's supposed. All you see is say whitening on the front. You understand? You different. You ain't you special. So, but ain't no black people I know look on the back of the tube or the toothpaste say, oh, it's got gloxamine and bling bloxabling or whatever the hell they be. Ain't nobody. We just say, oh, it say whitening on the front. It's gonna make my teeth white. I'm a brush, right or wrong. So if you want to go there, we can go there. If we want to go through semantics, but let's see what Christ kept. Get Matthew chapter 26 verse 17.
The book of Matthew, chapter 26, and verse 17.
Read.
Now the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying unto him, Where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover?
So they asked Christ, where you want us to prepare the Passover for you? Now let's see what Christ said. Read.
And he said, go into the city to such a man and say unto him, the master saith, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples.
So Christ kept the Passover, right? Christians don't keep the Passover. They keep whatever other pagan ritual or holiday that they want to keep. They don't keep the Passover, though. Go to John 7, verse 1. John 7, verse 1 and 2.
The book of St. John, chapter 7, and verse 1. After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Jewry, because the Jews sought to kill him. Now, the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand.
Skip down to 14.
Verse 14. Now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught.
So Christ kept the Feast of Tabernacles, right? And guess what? All nations going to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. Get that real quick in Zechariah chapter 14. I know the so-called white man and these other nations, you know, saying, oh, you ain't got to keep the commandments in Christ. We knew. They ain't, Christ ain't dealing with them at all. Zero. The Lord is not dealing with the other nations. The Lord only for the Israelites. This is why we getting our behinds jacked up. Because we God's people and we don't do what he say. So when a white man come to you saying, you ain't got to do that no more. Why are you keep, sister, why are you wearing fringes? Why are you wearing a head wrap? You don't have to do that. You understand? They come to you, you just tell them, hey, look, be gone. Zechariah 14, 16.
Zechariah chapter 14, verse 16. And it shall come to pass that every one that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem.
You hear what he says? Now, I want y'all to understand something. The God we serve is a vengeful God. And he just. So what we read right here is a future prophecy. He says, it shall come to pass that every one that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem. What does he mean by left? Who knows? Brother Joel, somebody pass him the mic. Who got the mic? Pass that to him. He right behind you. Just pass over your shoulder. What does he mean by everyone that is left of the nations that came against Jerusalem?
Shalom, leadership.
Shalom.
He mean by after the destruction of the nations.
Which means what? He going to do what?
Enslave them. Destroy the other nations. Then
when
enslave
you say
them.
Destroy, you got to be plain for black people. Kill. What is it? What is he going to do?
Kill.
When God kill these other nations. Because you got to speak plain because Jake yes, don't understand that. When the Bible says destroy, he mean kill. It's, I mean, I don't understand what destroy, when he gonna put them in the ghetto? No. He gonna kill them.
That's right.
You understand? Read it again. Read the scripture. Thank you, Joel. Read the scripture again. So yes, somebody might think we a hate group. Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all the nations.
So the reason why he says everyone that is left, meaning those that didn't get killed, the ones that he spared. Read.
Of all the nations which came against Jerusalem, shall even go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep the Feast of Tabernacles.
All nations going to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. Everybody going to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. Ain't going to be no, oh man, well, that's y'all God. I ain't got to do that. Oh, hell no. All nations going to come up and going to say, hey, can you show me what a door at for the tabernacle? Say, why go in at this way? Because I ain't from Jerusalem. This way? And we're going to be like, yeah, go right through that door right there. Keep your head down. Don't look none of the Israelites in their eyes. Every last one of y'all look at the ground the whole time. Don't touch our women. Don't look at our children. Can't wait. Keep reading.
Verse 17. And it shall be that whoso will not come up of all the families of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, even upon them shall be no rain.
The Lord, what is he saying? There shall be no rain. What is he saying? He gonna kill them. You can't grow nothing without rain. They ain't gonna get no crops. It's gonna be a famine in their land until they starve to death is what he's saying. If they don't wanna come up to keep the Feast of Tabernacles, our God ain't letting that go down. Understand that. I'll pray, get the Lord a round of applause for that, man. It's going down. You ain't keeping the commandments. It's over with for you. What you about to say, Austin?
I just want. Can I bring one scripture?
Yeah, he about to say something real quick. Okay. He had already.
Nah, I was just gonna stay in this chapter. Jump over to 13. Yes. And start at 2.
Yes, sir.
13 and 2. Cause we gonna have to realize we gotta let all this stuff go. We gotta let this thinking go. Maybe I can celebrate my birthday. Maybe I can celebrate Christmas. Ain't none of this, the stuff we got going on now, going to ever be here again. And we got to start training ourselves. You know what? Let me get out of this mindset. Because if we don't, this is what's going to happen. 13 and 2.
Yes, sir. Zechariah chapter 13 and verse 2.
Come on.
And it shall come to pass in that day.
In that day.
Saith the Lord of hosts.
Uh-huh.
That I will cut off the names of the idols.
It's going to all the idols that we worship today. Sesha Borzea, Krishna, Muslim. Everything we go into today and everything that this society bring forth. Christmas, Thanksgiving. If we talking about that stuff in that day, we done. Let's see what God say. What's going to happen.
That I will cut off the names of the idols out of the land.
Uh-huh.
And they shall no more be remembered.
We ain't going to remember none of this stuff that's going on now. We ain't going to be thinking about Christmas or Thanksgiving or birthdays. If we do, God going to put us to death. Read.
And also I will cause the prophets and the unclean spirit to pass out of the land.
Uh-huh.
And it shall come to pass that when any shall yet prophesy.
Talking about those idols or bringing up those things of the past about what we did or trying to bring in some other ideology or philosophy, read.
Then his father and his mother that begot him.
The Bible say a mom and a daddy gonna do what?
Shall say unto him, thou shalt not live.
The parents gonna be the one to cut that stuff out. Cut it out right then. They gonna kill him. Right then, right there. Read.
For thou speakest lies in the name of the Lord.
Uh-huh.
And his father and his mother that begot him shall thrust him through.
What, you talking about some Christmas? We don't do that. You talking about some sensible? Give me that knife. I'm finna cut him up right now. Here you go, baby. Take his head off. The parents gonna be cutting that stuff out.
Hey.
Killing them.
I'm telling you, you better thank God for Christ, man. The Lord sent his son to give us grace. You keep going, I just want to say this. You gotta thank God for the grace that he done gave us to get ourselves together. Because in that day, we ain't sparing nobody. Me, him, nobody getting spared. If you ain't keeping the law, you done. We going back to warrior mode. The men going to be men of God again, immortal. And we ain't playing. Nobody ain't finna break none of God's commandments. You know how you had that homeboy in the world that may have been feeble? Like he was your boy. And he had something wrong with him, you know, some type of sickness. And people would make fun of him. And you'd be like, hey, ain't nobody touching nothing around here, bro. You ain't touching. Get off my mans. You understand? Like you had his back, right? That's how it's going to be in that day with God. You break God's commandments, we taking your head clean off. We ain't going to even talk about it. You know, because nowadays gangsters talk about it. Nigga, no, not in that day. It ain't going to be. All you going to hear is, see? What the hell?
You ain't going to let no Christmas. What?
Hey, man, y'all remember back in the day, man, we used to keep thanks. And before you say it, before it even come out your mouth. So sing.
Over.
You done. I'm just telling you. It's going to get real when Christ returns. We're going to have to get our spirit right now. You had something you want to bring out? Okay. Go to John 10 and 22. So we saw what Christ kept the Feast of Tabernacles. In the kingdom of heaven, brothers and sisters, everybody going to have to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. All right? Go ahead. John 10 and 22 and 23.
Book of John, chapter 10, 22. And it was at Jerusalem.
The mic, feast. You good? Your mic good? Keep going out, sound like.
I don't know why it's doing that. The battery
is that new? That's a new mic?
No, sir.
Why y'all ain't get my man a new mic, man? He read.
Mic check, mic check.
This? Wow, he the reader. Right. Go ahead, Op.
John chapter 10, verse 22.
Okay.
And it was at Jerusalem, the feast of the dedication.
The feast of the dedication. The dedication. Read.
And it was winter time.
What time period we in now? Go ahead.
And Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch.
And Christ was there while they was doing. Now, you remember when Christ flipped tables over when they was doing evil in the house of the Lord. So if the Feast of Dedication was wicked and we shouldn't be doing it, Christ would have flipped some tables. You understand? He would have whooped some people with some switches. Y'all know Christ did that, right? Okay, I'll just wait till y'all make switches is biblical. Christ was whooping they behind with them switches. Make me no switches. Hey, pull up Hanukkah. I sent it to you, I believe. Look up the Hanukkah. Or maybe I didn't send it to you. Yes, I did. I sent you Hanukkah. Watch this. All right. So first of all, Esau don't keep Hanukkah. So don't let the pictures fool you. Just please scroll down because it's going to make me mad. Hanukkah. Okay, the history of Hanukkah. Right? So read that for us also once that get pulled down.
Yes, sir.
History of Hanukkah.
Can you zoom it in just a little bit more? You want that bottom part where the heading actually
just read
says?
That part right there.
Yes, sir.
You at, yes, sir.
Okay. The eight-day Jewish celebration known as Hanukkah or Hanukkah commemorates the rededication during the 2nd century BC of the second temple in Jerusalem, where, according to legend, Jews had risen up against their Greek-Syrian oppressors.
There ain't no legend. That happened. We're going to read it. Read.
In the Maccabean Revolt. Hanukkah.
Hold on. It's a word and I really won't. It says, to legend, Jews had risen up against the Greek. They're Greek. That's the Edomite. And Syrian oppressors in the Maccabean Revolt. Read.
Hanukkah, which means dedication in Hebrew.
That's all I wanted. Hanukkah, which means what?
Dedication
in Hebrew. So when we say we keeping Hanukkah, we are celebrating the feast of dedication, right? So now, let's start from the beginning. Go to Daniel chapter 8, because the feast of dedication was prophesied in the book of Daniel before it ever happened, showing you that Christians don't know what they're talking about, okay? Daniel chapter 8, and let's start at verse 1.
The book of Daniel chapter 8 and verse 1. In the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared unto me, even unto me, Daniel, after that which appeared unto me at the first.
Uh-huh.
And I saw in a vision, and it came to pass when I saw that I was at Shushan in the palace, which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in a vision, and I was by the river of Uli.
Go ahead.
Then I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had two horns.
So hold your finger there. Go to Hosea chapter 12, verse 10. What you'll understand is our forefathers saw visions, and the visions meant something, right? They were a similitude of one thing to another. So Daniel's seeing visions of a ram with two horns, right? And it's going to show you that it's symbolic of something else. Read what you got.
Hosea chapter 12 and verse 10.
Read.
I have also spoken by the prophets.
He's spoken by the prophets. Read.
And have multiplied visions.
And have multiplied visions. Read.
And use similitudes.
And use what?
Similitudes.
So when the Lord would come to them in a vision, he wouldn't tell them exactly what the vision was all the time. Sometimes he would show them a vision of an animal or something happening, right? But that vision meant something. It was pertaining to history or men. Read.
By the ministry of the prophets.
By the ministry of the prophets. Go back to Daniel 8, verse 3.
Daniel chapter 8 and verse 3. Then I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had two horns. And the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other. And the higher came up last.
So, hey, pull up the picture I had you to show them what we read right now. So Daniel saw a vision of a ram that had two horns, right? The ram had two horns. One of the horns was long or higher than the other, right? And the second came, and it said, the other and the higher came up last. The higher would be Artaxerxes, King Artaxerxes of the Persians and Medes. You read about that. You see about him in 300, right? You seen 300? Remember Xerxes? He had all the gold on his face, tall dude. Y'all remember that on 300? That's Xerxes. So that's also the husband of our foremother Esther. When you read in the book of Esther, you read it says Ahasuerus, right? Which is just a different translation of the name Artaxerxes or Xerxes. He was very, very rich, right? You had Cyrus the first, or Cyrus. He had his son Cambyses the second, and you had Darius the first. So those three kings came before Artaxerxes, and they destroyed everybody. So all he had to do was collect the money, right? Just get the wealth off the kingdom, right? So this is the ram that he saw. You see that horn on the right is shorter than the horn that's on the left? This is the vision that our forefather Daniel saw, all right? Go back to the verse.
Daniel chapter 8, verse 3.
Read verse 20 now.
Verse 20. The ram which thou sawest having two horns are the kings of Media and Persia.
You hear this? So he tell you what it is later on in the vision. He tell you, the Lord, the angel gives him the interpretation. That ram you saw were the kings of Media and Persia. So This happened. This is going on before it actually happened. You understand? So this is prophecy. We know it as history now, but the Bible calls it prophecy first. Then when it happens, the world calls it history, right? This is how you know the Bible real, right? So go back to Daniel chapter 8, read verse 4 now.
Verse 4. Daniel chapter 8, verse 4.
Yep.
And I saw the ram pushing westward and northward and southward.
So westward, northward, southward. Southward would be Egypt. Northward would be Assyria. Syria, he took over that. And then eastward would be India. He took over India. So he run all that. Babylon, India, Cyrus, and the lineage of the Persians and Medes, they ran all that. King Darius, they ran all that. Right? Come on.
So that no beast might stand before him. Neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand. But he did according to his will and became great.
Show me the video of Darius real quick off YouTube. So the Lord was with these brothers. You understand? The Lord was with these other nations because it was prophesied that these nations would come into power. So when you read in Isaiah, the 45th chapter, and we're not going to read it, it shows you where the Lord strengthened Cyrus's hand so he could defeat Babylon, right? He couldn't defeat Babylon without the Most High. The Most High allowed, sent the angels to help him win that battle. Now show this real quick. It's only 13 seconds. This is Darius. This is Darius of the Medes. Persians and Medes. And that's his army. Look at that great army behind him. Right? So this is what we just read. Read verse 4 again.
Daniel chapter 8 and verse 4.
Go ahead.
I saw the ram pushing westward.
So remember, the ram is what, brothers? The Persians and the Medes. We read it in verse 20. The ram symbolizes the kingdom of the Persians and Medes. Right? Read.
And southward, so that no beast might stand before him.
And no beast would be able to stand before him. Read.
Neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand.
And nobody can stop Darius and the Medes and Cyrus and those different Persian kings. They couldn't stop them. They was great warriors. Read.
But he did according to his will and became great.
He did whatever he wanted to do. He did it and became great. Now watch this. Show me the next picture of the ram and the goat. And read that. Read it, verse 5.
Verse 5. And as I was considering, behold, and he goat came from the west.
So see, look at this. While he was looking at that ram and how mighty it was, now here come a he goat out of nowhere. This is what he's seeing in the vision. Okay, come on.
And he goat came from the west.
Read.
On the face of the whole earth.
Read.
And touched not the ground.
Read.
And the goat had a notable horn between his eyes.
And this goat had a notable horn between his eyes. You see that horn, that one long horn between his eyes? Keep reading.
And he came to the ram that had two horns, which I had seen standing before the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power.
Read.
And I saw him come close unto the ram, and he was moved with choler.
Choler is anger. Read.
Against him, and smote the ram, and brake his two horns, and there was no power in the ram to stand before him.
Read.
But he cast him down to the ground, and stamped upon him, and there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand.
Man, he whooped that ram ass. That's what they're saying. This notable horn, when he came against that ram, he tore his ram down.
This some crazy stuff. Like this, right? Daniel dreaming, like, what the hell does this dream mean? Right. He's seeing rams and a goat just coming, like, this is crazy.
Yep.
I know I be having some crazy dreams. Well, imagine if you have a dream and the Most High sent you a crazy vision, and then he break it down to you. Okay, that means this.
Right.
This means that. That's what we reading about, like right. The officer was saying.
Right.
This was at one point a prophecy. Now it's history.
Right.
And everything else that's a prophecy is going to come to pass, and it's going to be history.
It's going to be history. That's right. Go to 1 Maccabees chapter 1 and verse 1. So what is this vision that he's seeing? Because this is a vision, right? He's seeing a vision of a ram with two horns that's mighty, that's ruling the world. And then all of a sudden, this he-goat with one notable horn come out of nowhere and smash this ram. And he's like, what is this I'm seeing? Let's show you the history. Read what you got.
1 Maccabees chapter 1 and verse 1.
Go ahead.
And it happened after that Alexander, son of Philip the Macedonian,
read,
who came out of the land of Shittim,
read,
has smitten Darius, king of the Persians and Medes.
You hear this? This is history we reading about. We reading about the history, but during the time of Daniel, it was what, brothers? Prophecy. Right? Go ahead.
that he reigned in his stead,
uh-huh.
the first over Greece.
The first over what?
Greece.
Go back to Daniel 8, read verse 20 and 21 together.
Daniel chapter 8, verse 20.
We're going to come back to 1 Maccabees 1. Read.
The ram which thou sawest, having two horns, are the kings of Media and Persia.
Read.
And the rough goat is the king of Grisha. And the great horn that is between his eyes is the first king.
You hear this? Is the first king. So Daniel saw Alexander the Greek before he was born. This is why I say people be talking about, oh, the Bible ain't real. You don't know the Bible. We read about the kings of Persia and Media being destroyed by Alexander the Greek before these brothers was even born, before they was even alive. Our forefather Daniel saw this vision in the spirit. You understand? You know what is also proved, brothers? The Apocrypha is 100% true. Because you know Christians say, oh, it ain't canonized. We shouldn't use it. It ain't right. The dates don't match up. Shut the hell up. The Bible say right here that he saw the vision of this happening before it happened. You have something you want to say, Austin?
Just for you newer folks, when we say Alexander the Greek, according to the Bible, now you may know him as Alexander the Great. That's right. What they call him. But right. we call him, according to the Bible, the Greek. He was first over Greece, so all praise.
Right. That's right. Go back to 1 Maccabees 1 and 1 again. Read 1 and verse 1 and verse 2.
Yes, sir. 1 Maccabees chapter 1 and verse 1.
Read.
And it happened. After that, Alexander, son of Philip, the Macedonian, who came out of the land of Shittim, had smitten Darius, king of the Persians and Medes.
Read.
That he reigned in his stead, the first over Greece.
So that first king, we just read about it. That horn that was in the middle of his head was the first king. That was what? Alexander who? The Greek. Read.
And made many wars.
And he made many wars.
And won many strongholds.
Uh-huh.
And slew the kings of the earth.
So he was bad. He was running through smashing everybody. This Edomite was bad. He was gay. You understand? He was a homosexual. He died of syphilis. He one of his lovers was Cassandra. One of his four generals was one of his lovers. So imagine that you getting whooped by he whooping everybody. He gay. You understand? Like, hey, show the video real quick. I sent you. He whooping everybody, man. He's a homosexual. Put it, to make it plain. All right, here we go. Show that. That's Darius, the king of Persia, and that's his army. It's a little graphic, it shows a little bloodshed, so we prove. So they at war. Now fast forward to like 4 minutes and 50 seconds. No, let me see, keep going, hold on, right there. So Darius, a mighty warrior, going against Alexander the Greek. So they in all out war right now. They fighting. Right? That's Darius right there sitting on his horse. Right? Yep. That's Alexander the Greek right there, supposedly. You see the leg. Hold it. Pause it. Go back. Like 2 seconds. Yep, right there. Pause it. Y'all see what he riding on? He riding on a horse, but you see under the horse, he got a blanket or skin. What is that called? Leopard print. Go to Daniel chapter 7.
Bring it out.
Go to Daniel chapter 7 and read verse. The white man know, man. I'm telling you, he know who he is. He know who his ancestors is. Verse 6. Yes, sir.
Daniel chapter 7 and verse 6. After this, I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard.
Like a what?
A leopard.
The reason they call Alexander the Greek a leopard is because he took over the earth in 12 years. It took him 12 years to destroy all nations and put them in subjection to him. So he was like a leopard. A leopard is very fast, right? Go ahead, finish it out. which had...
After this I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads.
Read.
And dominion was given to it.
And dominion was given unto it. Four wings and four heads. We're going to get to that in a minute. All right? So go back to Daniel chapter 8. So I show y'all saw Alexander the Greek. He destroyed Darius, king of the Medes, right? Persian and Medes. So go back to Daniel chapter 8 and read verse 7 again.
Daniel chapter 8 and verse 7. And I saw him come close unto the ram, and he was moved with choler against him, and smote the ram, and brake his two horns.
His kingdom, read.
And there was no power in the ram to stand before him.
He couldn't mess with him. Go ahead.
But he cast him down to the ground, and stamped upon him, and there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand.
Read.
Therefore the he-goat waxed very great.
Read.
And when he was strong, the great horn was broken.
So go back to 1 Maccabees. Read chapter 1 and read verse 2 and 3 and 4 now.
1 Maccabees chapter 1 and verse...
Read 2 through 5.
Yes, sir. 1 Maccabees chapter 1 and verse 2. And made many wars and won many strongholds and slew the kings of the earth.
So that's why they called him a leopard, read.
And went through to the ends of the earth and took spoils of many nations.
He robbed people.
And so much... that the earth was quiet before him.
Everybody was quiet. They weren't messing with him. That's why it said in Daniel chapter 8 and verse 8, therefore the he-goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken. Go ahead.
Whereupon he was exalted, and his heart was lifted up.
And he got prideful. Go ahead.
And he gathered a mighty strong host.
Meaning a mighty army. Go ahead.
And ruled over countries.
Read.
And nations.
Read.
And kings.
Read.
Who became tributaries unto him.
And they became tributaries unto him, meaning what? They had to pay him taxes. They had to pay him money. Go ahead.
And after these things, he fell sick.
And after that happened, he fell sick from what? Syphilis. Read.
And perceived that he should die.
And he knew that he was about to die. Right? Go back to Daniel chapter 8, verse 8. We'll come right back here to that verse, to verse 6. On 1 Maccabees. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Daniel chapter 8, verse 8. Therefore, the he-goat waxed very great.
So Alexander the Great became, the Greek became great. Read.
And when he was strong.
And when he was in the height of his kingdom. Read.
The great horn was broken.
How was the great horn broken, brothers? He died. Read.
And for it came up four noble ones toward the four winds of heaven.
It said four noble ones. Remember we just read in Daniel chapter 7 and verse 6. And it said that he had the back of it four wings of a fowl. That meant his army. And the beast had also four heads. And dominion was given to it. Go back to 1 Maccabees, chapter 1 and verse 6.
Bring it out. 1 Maccabees, chapter 1 and verse 6.
Watch this.
Wherefore he called his servants, such as were honorable, and had been brought up with him from his youth, and parted his kingdom among them while he was yet alive.
So he had his servants that came unto him. He had four servants that came unto him, right? Keep reading.
So Alexander reigned 12 years. And then died.
So he died. Go ahead.
And his servants bear rule, every one in his place.
It said his servants bear rule and every one in his place. Read.
And after his death, they all put crowns upon themselves.
And when he died, they all crowned themselves. Read.
So did their sons after them.
And their sons after them.
Many years. And evils were multiplied in the earth.
So before this time, the white man never ruled the whole earth. But as soon as the white man came in to rule of the whole earth, the Bible says what? Read it again.
And evils were multiplied in the earth.
Everything went bad. You understand? Everything went evil when he came into power because he is Satan. He the man of sin. The son of what? Perdition. He the son of destruction. Go ahead.
Hey, just a little side note. What did Esau call this man that started all this? Alexander the what? Because he was the first one to unify all the Edomites together. That's why they call him the great. We call him the Greek. All right. Praise.
Hey, show me the article I sent you about Alexander the Greek. So it said four noble ones came up after him. Who can name, before he pull it up, who can name those four noble ones? You can name it? Soldier Gerson? Okay, Soldier Gerson said he can name them. Oh, man, no brothers? Only one brother? Brother Gideon, you can try, you got it. No, you got to tell me. Just do you have it? You got it? Okay, well, let's see what Gershwin. I want to see what Soldier Gershwin got. Y'all brothers, hey, brothers, write this down in your notes. Y'all got to know this. This is your history. Because somebody might say, who is those noble ones that is talking about the crowns? What is that? You got to be able to tell them. Go ahead. What you got?
Shalom, leadership.
Shalom. Sign Christ bless, soldier.
Lysimachus.
Lysimachus.
Cassandra, Seleucus, and Ptolemy.
Y'all hear that? Say it for them slow real one more time.
Ptolemy, Cassandra, Lysimachus, and Seleucus.
Can you, do you know where they ruled at?
I can take a gab. No,
okay. Okay. All right. I'll praise. I'll pray. That's fine. Show the article. We're gonna give y'all a little help. We're gonna show you the article. So he had four generals: Lysimachus, Seleucus, Cassander, and Ptolemy. Those were his four generals. This is what the Bible prophesied. He would have four heads, and they would put crowns upon their head. The Bible told you that was gonna happen before it happened. Now think about this. God had our forefather Daniel prophesy that this man gonna die and have four people. And then it just so happened, then think about it. These people's born. Then they born years later. And it happened like God said. That's why I said, man, if you don't believe the God of this Bible, man, hey, you sleep. You lost in the sauce. So read this for us.
The Hellenistic world, the world of Alexander the Great, for a Greek.
Now go down. Okay. Yeah, keep going down. I just want to get to the generals. I don't want to read all that. Go down. It's right up here. Okay, all right, bet. Right there. Zoom in on that for us. All right, here we go. Read that at the top after Alexander's death.
After Alexander's death, his empire was divided among his four generals, known in Latin as the
Diadochi,
the name by which they are still referenced from the Greek. I can't see that word.
Diadochoa,
meaning successors.
So they were his successors, like the Bible said they would be. Sorry, go ahead.
Lysimachus, who took Thrace and much of Asia Minor.
So Lysimachus took Thrace and Asia Minor. Go ahead.
Cassander controlled Macedonia.
He gave Cassander where he was from, Macedonia and Greece. I wonder why he gave that to Cassander. Go ahead.
Ptolemy the First ruled Egypt.
So Ptolemy ruled Egypt.
Palestine,
Cilicia,
Petra,
and Cyprus.
He founded the Ptolemaic dynasty, which lasted until the death of Cleopatra the VII.
So how many of y'all knew Cleopatra was a white woman? Y'all sisters didn't know that? Cleopatra wasn't black. She was a white woman. She was the daughter of Ptolemy. That was his lineage of daughters. So you know how they said, I remember when I was song, they had a song. I can't remember who sung. It was a little girl group. They say Cleopatra coming at you. You remember that song? Well, 3LW, they had a little song called Cleopatra coming at you. They sit up here talking about the white woman. They didn't even know. And you wonder why they had perms in their head and blonde in their head. Because they was thinking about the white woman. Cleopatra was a white woman. She wasn't no Egyptian goddess. She wasn't Nefertiti. You understand? She was a white woman. She was an Edomite. All right? Go to the next one.
Seleucus the First Nicator ruled the remainder of Asia and founded the Seleucid Empire.
Read.
Which was comprised of Mesopotamia.
So Seleucid had Mesopotamia, which is where what was? Israel was. He ruled our area. Go ahead.
The Levant. Persia. And part of India.
Right. Go back to Daniel chapter 8 and pick back up at verse 8. No. Go back to 1 Maccabees. No, you finished that, didn't you? Okay, go back to Daniel chapter 8, and let's pick up at verse 9 now.
Daniel chapter 8 and verse 9. And out of one of them came forth a little horn.
And out of one of them came forth a little horn. Read.
Which waxed exceeding great toward the south and toward the east and toward the pleasant land.
What's the pleasant land, brothers? Jerusalem, Israel. You understand? So it says, and out of them came forth a little horn. Go back to Maccabees, chapter 1, read verse 10 now.
1 Maccabees, chapter 1 and verse 10. And there came out of them a wicked brute, Antiochus, surnamed Epiphanes, son of Antiochus the king, who had been an hostage at Rome. And he reigned in the 137th year of the kingdom of the Greeks.
So pull up. Antiochus, Epiphanes. I just want them to see what Epiphanes means. Look it up on Wikipedia. So this is history we're going through. We're going through the history of the Feast of Dedication, why we keep it. But this history is important because we got to understand how these things came to pass, how these people come into power like this. The Bible tell you how it happened before it happened. You got that? Antiochus Epiphanes. What does Epiphanes mean? Just go to Antiochus. It should be Wikipedia. It'll tell you what Epiphanes means. That was that wicked root that came out of one of them, like you said in Daniel. Go back to Daniel chapter 8, verse 9 again.
Daniel chapter 8, verse 9.
Yes, sir.
And out of one of them came forth a little horn, which waxed exceeding great.
Read.
Toward the south.
Uh-huh.
And toward the east.
Read.
And toward the pleasant land.
Read.
And it waxed great even to the host of heaven.
It waxed great even to the host of heaven. Think about what he's saying. Read.
And it cast down some of the host.
Read.
And of the stars to the ground.
Read.
And stamped upon them.
Read.
Yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host.
He magnified himself even to the prince of the host. Read that about about Antiochus Epiphanes. Read that. Read that.
Somebody just a little bit more, like one more time. Because I can't see that. Can you zoom in one more time?
You can't see that?
No, I can't see that.
Okay, zoom in for him. I read it. It says Antiochus the Fourth, Epiphanes. It says, if you look in parentheses right there, it says Antiochus ho Epiphanes, God manifest. You hear this? God manifest. That's what Epiphanes means. So what was he saying he was, y'all? He said he was God on earth. Who was a God on earth? Jesus Christ, the black Messiah. You understand? So he's saying he the God that was manifested on earth. Because the Lord sitting on his throne never came down to earth. He sent his son to the earth. So he's saying he likened in the Son of God. Y'all understand? That makes sense? Go back. Go back to Daniel chapter 8. Read verse 10 again.
Daniel chapter 8 verse 10. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven.
So this waxed great is Antiochus or Antiochus Epiphanes. Read.
And it cast down some of the host.
It cast down some of the host. Read. We're going to get to what that means. Read.
And of the stars to the ground.
Uh-huh.
And it stamped upon them.
Read.
Yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host.
The prince of the host. Go to Isaiah 9 and 6. Who the prince of the host? That he magnified himself against. That he said he was.
The book of Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6.
Read.
For unto us a child is born.
Read.
Unto us a son is given.
Read.
And the government shall be upon his shoulders.
And the government shall be upon his shoulders. Read.
And his name shall be called Wonderful.
Wonderful.
Counselor.
Counselor.
The Mighty God.
Uh-huh.
The Everlasting Father.
Read.
The Prince of Peace.
The what?
The Prince of Peace.
Who this talking about, y'all? Jesus Christ. Prophesying about Jesus Christ before he was born. Right? On earth, at least. Right? So go back to chapter 8 and read verse 10 one more time.
Daniel chapter 8 verse 10. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven. And it came down, it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground and stamped upon them.
Read.
Yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host.
The prince of the host is Jesus Christ. Read.
And by him the daily sacrifice was taken away. And the place of the sanctuary was cast down.
So it said he magnified himself against the stars of heaven and stamped upon them, right? Let's see who that is. Go to 1 Maccabees chapter 1 verse 20.
1 Maccabees chapter 1 and verse 20.
Go ahead.
And after that, Antiochus had smitten Egypt.
Uh-huh.
He returned again in the 143rd year.
Read.
And went up against Israel.
And went up against who?
Israel.
So we the stars he came against. Read.
And Jerusalem.
Go ahead. With a great multitude. Read.
And entered proudly into the sanctuary.
And he entered proudly into the sanctuary. Read.
And took away the golden altar.
And he took away what?
The golden altar.
Who knows where the golden altar was? Who knows? Damn, nobody? Y'all brothers. Hey, what you got, man? Y'all brothers got to stop watching these Revelation classes, man. Y'all need to get these basics. Where was the golden altar?
In the temple.
It was in the temple before the mercy seat, before you went into the most holy place. They burned incense on the altar of incense. You understand? Y'all understand that? Y'all brothers understand that? That's in Leviticus, the 16th chapter. All right? And many other chapters. Exodus chapter 30 as well, I believe. Go back. So it says he did what? And entered proudly into the sanctuary.
And entered proudly into the sanctuary.
Yes, sir.
And took away the golden altar.
The golden altar.
And the candlestick of light.
Read.
and all the vessels thereof.
What's the candlestick of light, brothers? The menorah. He took the menorah. Read. And the vessels thereof. Read.
And the table of the showbread.
Wait a minute. What was the table of the showbread? Inside the temple. Read. That was for the Levitical priest. Read.
And the pouring vessels.
And he took all the golden cups and everything we had. Read.
And the vials.
And the vials.
And the censers of gold.
Read.
And the veil.
Wait a minute. The veil? Where that supposed to lead to? The most holy place. There ain't nobody supposed to enter in there but the high priest. This dude magnified himself against God. The Bible says even the high priest, the Lord would put him to death if he went in there before the Day of Atonement. You understand? The Day of Atonement was the only day the high priest can go in there. He said, tell Aaron, he better not come up in here because my glory, he come in here, I'm going to put him to death. You understand? So if the priest couldn't do it, what make you think the white man was supposed to be okay to do it? That's why I say he magnified himself against the host. He went in there real proudly. Go ahead.
And the crowns and the golden ornaments.
Bam.
That were before the temple.
Read.
All of which he pulled off.
Read. He robbed us. Go ahead.
He took also the silver and the gold and the precious vessels. Also, he took the hidden treasures which he found.
Read.
And when he had taken all away, he went into his own land, having made a great massacre and spoken very proudly.
That's why I said he magnified himself against the host, the prince of the host. Go ahead.
Therefore, there was a great mourning in Israel, in every place where they were.
And everywhere we was at, we was mourning because all our gold, all our, this, think about this, our history, bro. I would liken it to, hit me out. One of these other nations, like 4th of July or something like that. Like, the white man ain't trying to give up that white Jesus, bro. He not giving up that white Jesus. You understand? Them statues. He ain't trying to give up them statues. He real deal mad about that. That's his legacy. That's his history. You understand? So this is our legacy. This is our history. This is our God. He come magnifying himself, so our people was mourning for that. We just been so disconnected from our God for so long. Now we don't think, nah, well, so what? He went to the temple. So what? But at that time, it's a big deal. You understand?
Like we reading it. And I hope we ain't, I was saying losing nobody. We reading this like, imagine somebody coming in here.
Right.
Like we got this school, got it beautified, and we leave, right? And we come back and it's vandalized. It's ransacked. TVs on the ground, busted up, table busted up, the kids' room jacked up. They got stuff all on the wall.
Right.
Who would be mad? Some of y'all be like, damn, I'm kind of glad they messed that place up. Come on. Who would be mad if they came and messed our school up? Put your hand up. Thank you. That's what same similar thing right here. But magnify that times 100.
Towards the Lord, too.
Magnify that times 100. They came in, did the temple like that.
Right.
And imagine, it's more glorious back then. It's more beautiful. We knew we was Israelites.
Right.
We was like there with it.
Our forefathers, Zechariah and them, and I mean, you know, Zerubbabel, they went and rebuilt the thing.
Right. So as we read it, that's what he's saying. They came and destroyed the temple, like bringing out in 1 Maccabees and the same thing in Daniel 8.
That's right.
They destroyed it. They messed it up. This is how it's tied into the rededication, which is the feast of dedication. Because they jacked it up. Now we bringing out the history, obviously going over history, got to be rededicated.
That's right. Go back to Daniel 8. Let's read verse 11 and 12 real quick. Because we running out of time, so I want to try to move through it a little quicker.
Yes, sir. Daniel chapter 8 and verse 11.
Read.
Yea, he magnified himself, even to the prince of the host. And by him the daily sacrifice was taken away.
It said, and by him the daily sacrifice was taken away. Come on.
And the place of his sanctuary was cast down.
And the place of his sanctuary was cast down. He cast down the sanctuary. It said the daily sacrifice was taken. He took the altar of incense. He took the showbread. He took all the vessels. He took everything out of there. You understand? And had a great massacre. He took our daily sacrifice from us. That's how we atone to God. He took us being able to be forgiven for our sins from our God. He took that from us. You see how now you see the magnitude? Now God ain't hearing us because we can't sacrifice in the temple like we supposed to. Y'all understand? That's how big it was, a big deal, right? Go back to Maccabees real quick. Go back to Maccabees, read 41.
1 Maccabees chapter 1, verse 41. Moreover, King Antiochus wrote to his whole kingdom that all should be one people, and everyone should leave his laws.
This is democracy. This is what America practices today. Read.
So all the heathen agreed according to the commandment of the king.
Go ahead.
Yea, many also of the Israelites consented to his religion.
It said, you see, democracy is a religion. That's why when America say, in God we trust, they mean in democracy. They ain't talking about the God of the Bible. They don't trust in the God of the Bible. Because if they trust in the God of the Bible, they would never oppress his children. Because they know the Bible say he going to destroy them for it. You understand? Go ahead.
And sacrificed unto idols.
Read.
And profaned the Sabbath.
And he profaned the Sabbath day. Come on.
For the king has sent letters by messengers unto Jerusalem and the cities of Judah, that they should follow the strange laws of the land and forbid burnt offerings and sacrifice.
You hear this? And forbid what?
Burnt offerings and sacrifice.
Read.
And drink offerings in the temple, and that they should profane the Sabbaths and festival days.
Man, he destroyed us, y'all. He destroyed us. Read.
And pollute the sanctuary.
He polluted the sanctuary of God. Read.
And holy people.
Read.
Set up altars and groves and chapels of idols and sacrifice swine's flesh.
And what'd he do?
Sacrifice swine's flesh.
That's like somebody coming in here, putting a damn pig in front of the damn place, and we come back to the school and it's all jacked up. Who gonna be mad? That's what we read.
Right.
Get into the story.
Right. Ahead, we come as a dead pig sitting right there with flies and stuff all around and maggots and all kind of.
Man, you finna be 38.
Our kids, gotta come, our women and kids gotta come here and see that mess. You understand? I heard a little mouse ran through this junk one day. They're like, oh God! And women standing on chairs. Oh!
Yeah.
You understand? So if imagine that. Somebody coming and disrespecting the house of the Lord like that. And he took away the sacrifices. Keep reading.
And sacrificed swine's flesh.
And then he sacrificed swine flesh in the temple of the Lord. Didn't eat him like the devil, man. Why say he the devil? You think God gonna let him get away with this? Because he died. You understand? He died when he got older. You think God ain't gonna punish this dude for this and his people? Best believe that. Read.
An unclean beast.
Uh-huh.
That they should also leave their children uncircumcised.
And then he made us. Why you think nowadays they try to charge you to get your children circumcised on the eighth day? They said, we'll do it the first day, but but they know that our children's vitamin K isn't at its highest until the eighth day.
That they should also leave their children uncircumcised.
Uh-huh.
And make their souls abominable with all manner of uncleanness and profanation.
Because it's unclean to not be circumcised. You understand? It's a reason God wants us to do that. It's not just because he commanded it. It also has health benefits. Right? Go ahead.
To the end they might forget the law and change all the ordinances.
They wanted us to forget the law and change the ordinances. Read.
And whosoever would not do according to the commandment of the king, he said he should die.
Skip down to 57. So he said if we didn't keep the commandments, he was going to kill us. Skip down to 56.
Verse 56.
And when they Hold had, on, 54.
54. Now, in the 15th day of the month Casleu, in the 145th year, they set up the abomination of desolation.
You heard about the abomination of desolation? We read about it right here. Go ahead.
Upon the altar.
Read.
And builded idol altars throughout the cities of Judah.
Uh-huh.
On every side.
Read.
And burnt incense at the doors of the houses.
Uh-huh.
And in the streets.
Read.
And when they had rent in pieces the books of the law.
So wait a minute. You mean to tell me the white man a Christian now, but back then he ripped the Bible up? This man ain't no Christian. He lied to you and told you he's a Christian. He took the Bible and ripped it up. He said, man, don't let them Negroes read that. Because they read that, they're going to do what it say, and they're going to rule over us again. Tear it up. Read.
Which they found. They burnt them with fire.
And they burnt the Bible. Disrespected the Bible. Read.
And whatsoever was found with any, the book of the testament.
And wherever they caught you reading it. Read.
Or if any consented to the law.
If they caught you wearing fringes or a beard. Read.
The king's commandment was that they should put him to death.
You hear this? You had to die if they caught you reading the Bible. You understand that? But now in 2020, they got you tricked thinking they Christians. That this is a Christian nation. Absolutely not. He always hated our word and our God. What you got, Austin?
Hey, that movie Mandingo.
Right.
Jericho, right before they hung him, that's why they hung Jericho.
Right.
Y'all seen that movie? Yeah. Jericho was teaching the slaves how to read.
Right. Who learned you, man?
Yep. Right. And that's why they killed Jericho. So all praise to the Most High.
They ain't want us reading that Bible. That's why Nat Turner said, man, look, slaves having meetings everywhere. Every scripture they use for our enslavement, there's another one demanding our freedom. He said, oh, wait, whoa, 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 look at this. He was reading the Bible. He's like, wait a minute. This is why they didn't want us reading it. Because if we read it, then we're going to see all this. You understand? Now, go from there. Let's go to 1 Maccabees chapter 2, verse 1. We're going to try to run through this real quick. We got 15 minutes, so we're going to run through the rest of it real quick. First Maccabees chapter 2, verse 1.
First Maccabees chapter 2 and verse 1.
Go ahead.
In those days arose Mattathias, the son of John, the son of Simeon, a priest of the sons of Joiarib.
So he was of what tribe, brothers? He was a tribe of Levi. He was a priest, right? Go ahead.
From Jerusalem and dwelt in Modin.
Read.
And he had five sons.
He had five sons. Think of the names.
Joannan, called Caddis.
Read.
Simon, called Thassi.
Read.
Judas, who was called Maccabeus.
That's a mighty man right there. Read.
Eleazar, called Avarin.
Read.
And Jonathan, whose surname was Apphus. And when he saw the blasphemies that were committed in Judah and Jerusalem, he said, woe is me. Wherefore was I born to see the misery of my people and of the holy city, and to dwell there when it was delivered into the hand of the enemy, and the sanctuary into the hand of the strangers.
Read.
Her temple is become as a man without glory.
Read.
Her glorious vessels are carried away into captivity. Her infants are slain in the streets. Her young men with the sword of the enemy.
Man, it's the same thing happening today, man. The same thing happening today. Read.
What nation have not had a part in her kingdom?
In all the nations. It wasn't just the white man. Chinese or Moab, Ammon, Philistines, all nations was against us and still against us to this day. Ishmael, which is the Arabs today, Elam, which is the so-called East Indian, all nations against us. Read.
And gotten of our spoils.
And gotten of our spoils. Get down to 17.
Verse 17.
Then 16, I'm sorry.
Verse 16. And when many of Israel came unto them, Mattathias also and his sons came together.
Read.
Then answered the king's officers and said to Mattathias on this wise, thou art a ruler and an honorable and great man in this city, and strengthened with sons and brethren.
Read.
Now therefore, come thou first, and fulfill the king's commandment, like as all the heathen have done.
Wait a minute. They trying to get this brother to coon. You see this, don't you? They said, man, look, you got family. People look up to you. You got a position. Go out here and tell these people to serve the white man. Tell them to serve white Jesus. Why you think Creflo Dollar and them got so much money? Why you think T.D. Jakes and them got so much money? Because they coons, they puppets for the white man. It's the same thing. They was trying to get our forefather Mattathias to do that. Hey, man, just tell him to serve the king. It'll be all right. Go ahead.
Yea, and the men of Judah also.
Read.
And such as remain at Jerusalem.
Read.
So shalt thou and thine house be in the number of the king's friends.
You will be the king's friend. We'll take care of you. Read.
And thou and thy children shall be honored with silver.
We'll give y'all money. That why you think they still teaching white Jesus to this day? When you got prophets on the corner, every Saturday, 365 every day, teaching on the internet. Bishop been going at T.D. Jakes and them. I know they see these videos. One of their members say, man, this dude from wearing this purple, he getting on y'all ass. Every week he on y'all. They see it, they know it, but they like to hell with him. I ain't saying nothing. I ain't going to respond. I'm going to keep teaching white Jesus because I got a $45 million mansion and a $30 million church that I'm in charge of. To hell with him. Let him just talk. Oh, but God going to bring destruction on them coons. The Lord do not like coons. The Lord do not like traitors. Go ahead.
And thy children shall be honored with silver and gold.
Read.
And many rewards.
Read.
Then Mattathias answered and spake with a loud voice.
He got real loud. Let's see what he said. Read.
Though all the nations that are under the king's dominion obey him.
Read.
And fall away every one from the religion of their fathers.
Read.
And give consent to his commandments.
Read.
Yet will I and my sons and my brethren walk in the covenant of our fathers.
That's right. That's right. We ain't keeping no Christmas. We ain't celebrating no birthdays. Hell no, you can't be no homosexual. You understand? You got to repent, brother. Sister, you can't wear that. You understand? We're going to tell our people the commandments of God. That's y'all. Y'all the prophets. The same spirit that's in him is in you, brothers. God called you to go out there and teach our people to repent. You understand? Read.
God forbid that we should forsake the law.
He said, God forbid we forsake the law. Read.
And the ordinances.
And the ordinances. Read.
We will not hearken to the king's word.
We ain't doing nothing the king say. Read.
To go from our religion.
Read.
Either on the right hand or the left.
We ain't going nowhere. We ain't celebrate nothing our God didn't say to celebrate. That's right. Read.
Now, when he had left speaking these words.
Read.
There came one of the Jews in the sight of all.
And then he come a coon. So why he saying this? He come a coon running up here to do what the dude said. Read.
To sacrifice on the altar.
Read.
Which was at Modin.
Read.
According to the king's commandment.
Go ahead.
Which thing when Mattathias saw.
When he saw this. Read.
He was inflamed with zeal.
He was so mad. He was pissed off. Imagine having this big speech. And then a Negro just come out of nowhere. And go sacrifice the animal. Man, what the hell? You didn't just hear what I said?
Negro.
You didn't just. Negro.
Right.
You didn't see this? You understand? This is what we reading.
Right.
Imagine how you feel after you just break down. We ain't supposed to buy on the Sabbath. Then the dude leave the camp
and go
in the store and come back out with a drink. Like, right. What was y'all saying?
Right.
Negro, we could have gave you a bottle of water.
Right.
You gonna go in there and break the Sabbath? We just read the scripture to you. Do you know how mad they make you? Same thing. Piss you off. Read.
And his reins trembled.
Read.
Neither could
he. So he got the shaking. You know how you be just. Ah! He was mad. Read.
Neither could he forbear to show his anger.
He couldn't stop. Read.
According to judgment.
Read.
Wherefore he ran and slew him upon the altar.
That's what we showed you. That's what I was at Lavin Pool earlier. When we see somebody breaking the commandments in the kingdom of God, right. He done. I'm telling you, he done. Go ahead.
Also, the king's commissioner
Read.
Who compelled men to sacrifice.
And he killed the commissioner, too. You bring your behind down here talking about we going to serve your God. Hell no. You dead and the dude I seen do it. Go ahead.
He killed at that time.
Read.
And the altar he pulled
then
down.
Then he snatched the altar and threw it down. Read.
Thus dealt he zealously for the law of God.
Read.
Like as Phinehas did unto Zimri, the son of Salam.
Read.
And Mattathias cried throughout the city with a loud voice, saying, whosoever is zealous of the law
Read.
And maintaineth the covenant,
Read.
Let him follow me.
Y'all come ride with me. We finna tear all this down. You understand? Go to 42. Hey. Go ahead.
That let you know you gotta choose a side.
Right.
You must choose a side. That's it.
That's right. Go ahead.
Hey, you see what kind of man that dude was? What you think his son's gonna do? Yeah.
They rolling too.
Right.
They rolling too. Matter of fact, skip down to verse 65.
Verse 65.
65, yeah, because we're going to move on.
And behold, I know that your brother Simon is a man of counsel.
So Simon was wise. He was very wise. He was a man of counsel. He wasn't really a warrior like that. He'll get out on you now. Don't think it's no joke. Our forefather was bad. He was just the brains of the operation. That makes sense? Go ahead.
Give ear unto him always.
Read.
He shall be a father unto you.
He going to guide y'all. Go ahead.
As for Judas Maccabeus.
He said, but Judas Maccabeus, though? This one right here? Read.
He have been mighty and strong, even from his youth up.
You know how y'all got kids. You got sons. Right. You know how you can see differences in your sons? Right. Like, yeah, that one right there. Yeah, he going to be smart. He going to be real smart. That one right there. I got to snatch him off kids at the playground every day. He whooping everybody kids, man. They come at me talking about their kid got black eyes and sore necks and throats. He done whooped everybody at the playground. Man, get that boy out the playground. Right. So you can see, he saw that. He said, Judas, yeah, that's the one right there. He mighty. Read.
Let him be your captain.
He going to be your captain. Read.
And fight the battle of the people.
And he going to fight the battle of the people. Skip down to 3 verse 1.
First Chapter Maccabees 3 verse 3 1. And 1.
Now we're going to read about Judas Maccabees, our forefather, real quick.
Then his son Judas, called Maccabeus, rose up in his stead.
Uh-huh.
And all his brethren helped him. And so did all they that held with his father. And they fought with cheerfulness the battle of Israel.
That's why you got to be happy to do the work of the Lord. You got to be happy to go to camp. You got to be happy to go on fly. You got to be happy to come to Men of Valor. Come to the Sabbath. To learn about your ancestors. To learn what you got to do to get the kingdom of God. So we can rule these weak nations that we're supposed to be above. Our sisters are supposed to be princesses. Like the bishop said, God is level. They ain't going to never get there if we don't get ourselves together. It ain't going to be a kingdom full of women. The men got to lead, brothers. Y'all understand that? Yes, y'all understand that? Yes, so we gotta raise up our people, bro. Don't play no more. If you playing, smoking, doing whatever you're doing behind closed doors, let that go, man. Put it to the side, bro. It's time to take over this world. We're going to do it with the word of God. Read what you got, verse 3.
So he got his people great honor.
He got his people great honor. People was honoring the Israelites because this brother was so bad. Read.
And put on a breastplate as a giant.
Read.
And girt his warlike harness about him. And he made battles, protecting the host with his sword.
He protected our people with his sword. Wasn't nobody touching us. You understand? Go ahead.
And his axe, he was like a lion.
He was like a lion. Read.
And like a lion's whelp, roaring for his prey.
Go ahead.
For he pursued the wicked.
The wicked is the other nations. Read.
And sought them out.
Read.
And burnt up those that vexed his people.
Man, I don't know about y'all, but when I read this, I get hype. I'm like, man, this dude was bad. They was the kings. We just read by Alexander the Greek.
Right.
They ruled the whole earth. Now this black man come out of nowhere snatching these folks up, burning their bodies alive, telling them, you ain't touching my people. You understand that? That's the type of power our ancestors had. This is why they give us white images of Jesus. This is why they give us white images of Moses and all the Israelites. Because the Israelites was always known as warriors. We can't let them know they're warriors. They can war against each other. Let them kill each other. But don't never let them get that warrior mindset towards us. Are they finished? Read.
Wherefore the wicked shrunk for fear of him.
They were scared. You know how you come out, you be like, oh, hey, mess with that.
Right.
So we said, you want somebody too, old man? No. I don't know why you come around here messing with these people. Right. You understand? When they seen how mighty he was, they was like, yo, you know, we straight. Right. We gonna go on holler at you. Go ahead.
And all the workers of iniquity were troubled.
Read.
Because salvation prospered in his hand.
Wow, go ahead.
He grieved also many kings.
So the kings was grieving the brother, read.
And made Jacob glad with his act.
And our people was happy, go ahead.
And his memorial is blessed forever.
And he's going to be known forever, read.
Moreover, he went through the cities of Judah, destroying the ungodly out of them and turning away wrath from Israel. And
he put his own people to death that was coons, didn't want to keep the commandment, read.
So that he was removed unto the utmost part of the earth.
Read, he was renowned, read that again.
Excuse me. So that he was renowned unto the utmost part of the earth.
Read.
And he received unto him such as were ready to perish.
Think about this. Wasn't no Instagram back then. Right. Wasn't no YouTube. Wasn't no newspapers.
Word spread fast.
Hey, man, look. It's an Israelite down there in Jerusalem. I mean, y'all better get down. Bro, I ain't playing. He whooping everybody. You ain't heard what he did to these folks?
Right.
Man, I'm straight. But they don't fear us like that now. You understand? They don't fear us like that now. Skip over to chapter 4, and let's read verse 57 through 59. These are my last three scriptures.
Yes, sir. First Maccabees, chapter 4, and verse 57.
Start at 56.
56. And so they kept the dedication of the altar 8 days and offered burnt offerings with gladness and sacrificed the sacrifice of deliverance and praise.
So we celebrated Hanukkah, or the Feast of Dedication, for 8 days. Why? Because our forefather Judas Maccabees went through and smashed the heathen and took the temple back for us, and we rebuilt it and we decorated it. Go ahead. Like these sisters over here, they're gonna decorate this school, have this school looking real fly in a couple days. All praise to the Most High. That's what our ancestors did at that time. Read.
They decked also the forefront of the temple with crowns of gold.
Read.
And with shields.
Y'all sisters got y'all crowns of gold and y'all shields. Y'all gonna turn up for us? I know y'all gonna have it looking good. I ain't worried about it. We got some shields up here already. All praise. They gonna look good. Go ahead.
And the gates and the chambers, they renewed and hanged doors upon them.
Uh-huh.
Thus was there very great gladness among the people.
Read.
For that the reproach of the heathen was put away.
That's why when we come here for the Feast of Dedication, whatever you got going on outside, leave it there. Enjoy that. Enjoy those days. Why? Because our forefathers, Judas Maccabees and his brothers, put their lives on the line to get our altar back, to get our temple back and rebuild it, to dedicate it back to the Father. You understand? And destroyed the heathen. Y'all understand that? Go ahead.
Moreover, Judas and his brethren, with the whole congregation of Israel, ordained that the days of the dedication of the altar should be kept in their season from year to year, by the space of 8 days, from the 5th and 20th day of the month Kislew, with mirth and gladness.
With what?
Mirth and gladness.
So we supposed to be happy when that time come around. That is November 24th through November 1st. I mean December 1st. November, is that right? December 24th through November to December 1st. November 24th through December 1st, I believe. That's the dates, right? So what day is December? What day is November 24th? What day is that? That's a Tuesday night. It's in November. Yes, November. So that's in a week. That's next week. That's not this week, but the week after. So we finna get it in. We finna turn up. You know, I pray all you are able to show up and be there. All right? Because this is a feast day, and y'all see why we got to keep it. Okay? So I pray all y'all got something.
We used to scream black power while Heron was pushed. But at the end of the day, nothing's in vain. IUIC has been given a vision. The tents of Judah has risen. Many has attempted the mission, minor murmuring, omitting, and missing the mark. Just reading that he had the flame of fire in his eyes gave us the spark. We on Paul's mission. We out on the road, purple and gold, from Mexico, Cuba, Haiti, Ghana, Sierra Leone. 144,000 boots banging, concrete crackling. These are how men repented at heart. The scriptures is proof. IUIC, we deliver the truth.